Let's try the second case when you have complex conjugate eigenvalues. This is our system of linear first order equations. We should put them in matrix form. So we have d dt of x1, x2 equals minus 1 half 1 minus 1 minus 1 half times x1, x2. We try our ansatz, try x of t equals the constant vector times e to the lambda t. That gives us our eigenvalue problem, av equals lambda v. The eigenvalues are computed from the characteristic equation. So we have the determinant of A minus lambda I. Here, because the diagonal elements are equal, we can subtract lambda from the diagonal and then compute the determinant. So we would get lambda plus a half squared minus minus 1 or plus 1 equals 0. We can bring the minus 1 on the right and then take the square root, so we get I. So then lambda is equal to negative 1 half plus I. And we also have lambda equals negative 1 half minus I. So the second eigenvalue will just be the complex conjugate of the first eigenvalue. In fact, you can see that from this eigenvalue equation. If A is a real matrix, if we take the complex conjugate of both sides, we would get A times V bar equals lambda bar times V bar, which means that if lambda is an eigenvalue, then so is lambda bar, the complex conjugate of lambda. And if V is an eigenvector, then so is V bar. OK, so now we need to find the two eigenvalues. So let's do that here. But we actually only need one eigenvector with this eigenvalue, because the other one is just the complex conjugate. So if lambda is equal to minus 1 half I, minus 1 half plus I, then the eigenvalue is always A minus lambda I V equal to 0. And we need to subtract lambda from the diagonal. So minus 1 half minus minus 1 half is 0. So we subtract lambda, we end up with minus I 1. And then minus 1 minus I times our eigenvector, because there's only there's an eigenvector and its complex conjugate. We can write that as v1, v2, and that's supposed to be equal to the 0 vector. OK, the second equation should be minus I times the first equation. So we only need one of these equations. So we have minus I v1 plus v2 equals 0 from the first row. So we get our eigenvector v is equal to, I can take v1 equals 1, and then v2 is equal to I times v1, which is I. Okay. So we have our lambda eigenvalue, minus 1 half plus I, and we have our associated eigenvector is 1i. Then we also have lambda bar, minus 1 half minus I, and v bar, which is 1 minus I. So when you have a complex eigenvalue and a complex eigenvector, you have a complex solution of the differential equation. We would like to have two real solutions So we can use the usual principle of superposition. If we have a complex function z and its complex conjugate z bar as solutions, then we can form z plus z bar divided by 2. That's the real part of z. And we can form z minus z bar divided by 2i. That's the imaginary part of z. So the two real solutions here will be the real part of v e to the lambda t and the imaginary part of v e to the lambda t. So how do we compute then the general solution? So the general solution will be given by x of t will be the real part of v e to the lambda t plus the imaginary part of v e to the lambda t. And of course, you should multiply this by constants. So we should sneak a constant in here. So this should be a c1, and this should be a c2. Okay? So we're using the principle of superposition. So x of t is a constant times the real part of v e to the lambda t plus another constant times the imaginary part of v e to the lambda t. So what are those going to be? So we have the real part, we have v, and we have lambda. So we have c1. The e to the lambda t is e to the minus t over 2 is the real part. So we have a c1 e to the minus t over 2. And then we're going to have the real part of our vector, which is 1i. And then e to the it. So we had the e to the minus t over 2 is the real part of the eigenvalue. And then we have I, so we have an e to the it, which is cosine t plus I sine t. Okay, that's the first piece, the real part. The second piece is the imaginary part, so plus c2 times e to the minus t over 2, and then the imaginary part of 1i cosine t plus I sine t. Okay, now we have to unfold this. We do this as carefully as we can. What do we get here? So we get c1 e to the minus t over 2. And then this is a column vector, right? We have a vector here, 1i times a scalar, cosine t plus I sine t. So this is a column vector. The first row of the column vector is the real part of cosine t plus I sine t. That's just cosine t. The second row of the column vector is the real part of I cosine t minus sine t. I squared is minus 1 minus sine t. So the real part will have a minus sine t. The second term is plus c2 times e to the minus t over 2. And again, another column vector. It's the imaginary part of the first row, which is the imaginary part of cosine t plus I sine t, which is sine t. And the imaginary part of the second row, which is I cosine t minus sine t. So the imaginary part then is cosine t. Okay, that's our solution. C1 e to the minus t over 2 times cosine t minus sine t plus C2 times e to the minus t over 2 times sine t cosine t. Let me review. Here we're doing the case when we have complex conjugate eigenvalues. So in matrix form, this is our system of first order equations. Our usual ansatz is x of t equals a constant vector times e to the lambda t. When we solve the characteristic equation, we get two eigenvalues. Lambda equals minus 1/2 plus I, and lambda bar, which would be minus 1/2 minus I. I showed you that the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors show up in complex conjugate pairs. That's the case when the matrix A is real. We found the eigenvector associated with lambda, that is 1i. And then we used the principle of superposition to construct two real functions. Those are going to be the real part of x and the imaginary part of x. And then we superimpose those two real functions, c1 times the real part plus c2 times the imaginary part. By accident, I dropped the constants, but for the general solution, we need two free constants. And then we have to unfold it, figure out what is the real part, what is the imaginary part. And then we get the solution for x1 then would be the first row. The solution for x2 would be the second row. I'm Jeff Chasnov. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.